So the citizens of Münster, in some confusion, go uncertainly to their homes. In the Berninck home, the young boy Christian is dying of starvation. As he departs this life, he has a vision of God in his glory. And his mother and Divara sing a lament. A lament rudely broken into by soldiers sent by Bokelson to take Divara to become his wife.
Husband is angry. He desires you.
My husband has his many wives and children. Let him lecture after one of them.
It's you whom he seeks. Come now.
Back in the town square, the sound of the bass trumpet announces more claims by the false limping prophet. He convinces everyone that God's prophet is about to lead them to the New Jerusalem. And Bokelson arrives with a richly dressed retinue, including Divara, and tables for a feast are set up. Bokelson and Divara bless cakes and wine and distribute them in imitation of Holy Communion. And hysteria mounts. At its peak, Bokelson punctures it. There is no journey to the New Jerusalem. This was just a test. The people are confused, so Bokelson commands a play for them, the play of Dives and Lazarus. The people watch as Dives, the rich man, accompanied by a stage band, eats his luscious food. Bokelson makes them realize that the rich are their enemies who must be destroyed, and then takes the role of the poor man, Lazarus, begging for food and being rejected. A little dance of death, in which the Dies Irae is prominent, depicts the death of Dives, and from hell he repents of his life of sin. But Bokelson, now taking the role of God the Father, refuses to acknowledge the repentance. All sin, especially the rich man's sin, must be mercilessly punished. And dropping the mask of God, he throws himself on Dives, and to general acclamation orders the innocent actor to be strung up. Divara tries to restrain his evident mental derangement. She begs the people to remember their earlier hopes and aspirations, their love and peace. But all Bokelson can think of is vengeance and the sword. For the first time, Bokelson is physically restrained by his followers. But first, the sounds of the bass trumpet announcing the words of the limping prophet.
Thank you. dear brothers and sisters, it was never my intention, nor is it the will of God, that we should evacuate our city. This was just your test.
Our test? What does he mean?
Come, come, let us be joyful. Let us dance. And now, that you may learn, we'll pass the time and make a play. The play of the rich man and of Lazarus.
table, give me bread. I bid you hear, I pray you, I pray you, give me alms and cheer.
Oh,
him.
What's he doing to me? Where are you taking me? This isn't in the play.
Divara's words and the debilitating effects of the siege produce results. That night, the city gates are unlocked from within, and the Catholic-Lutheran alliance carry out a terrible carnage of the Anabaptists. The next morning, the few Anabaptists who survive are in chains and in shock. As they pray that their plight be not hard to endure, the victorious Prince Bishop interrogates the unbowed Bokelson. Neither man understands the other. They're opposite poles of intolerance. Divara wrests herself from her captors and addresses the audience. Is it the people's fault that their dreams and aspirations have been ruined? We reaped a poisoned harvest we didn't sow. But they still have their hope. Their struggle will begin again. First, though, the opening of the city gates and the carnage of the Anabaptists.
God tells you.
Name have you usurped the power of the land?
Becomes a death's head. It begins again. Divara's words of optimism, despite the crushing of all her aspirations, bring to an end Alexander Goehr's opera, Behold the Sun. To a text based on historical events in Münster in the mid-1530s by the composer and John McGrath. Divara was sung by Carol Farley, Bokelson by Philip Langridge, and Johann Matthys by Philip Joel. Mr. Berninck was Peter Christoph Runge, Mrs. Berninck, Fiona Kim, and their son Christian, Selina Lindsley. The Limping Prophet, Ian Cayley, and Divies, Justin Lavender. The Prince Bishop was John Tranter, his servant, Harry Nicol, Knipperdollinck, Norman Wellesby, the Blacksmith, Stephen Richardson, the Fishwife, Mary Thomas, and the Anabaptist Captain, Jeremy White. With the Tiffin Boys Choir, Chorus Master Neville Creed, and the BBC Singers, Chorus Master Simon Jolly. Simon Jolly was also an associate conductor with Ray Holden of the BBC Symphony Orchestra, leader Bela Decany. The repetiteur was James Holmes, and the opera was conducted by Sir John Pritchard. It was produced in our Maida Vale studios by Clive Bennett.